Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Infected, a post-apocalyptic survival thriller by Kellee L. Greene. Narrated by Patricia Santomasso. Chapter 1. It was surprising that the number of tears I'd shed over the last 24 hours hadn't flooded the SUV. Losing Dax had left an empty spot inside the car, but also a deep hole inside my heart. The guard that worked for James had shot him without hesitation. It wasn't because of luck that we'd gotten away. We'd escaped because Dax sacrificed himself. He shouldn't have done it. We could have figured out another way. But I guess at the time, he hadn't seen another way. Blake was struggling with the loss of his brother, but he did the best to hide it from us. He didn't want anyone to worry about him. At least, that was how it seemed. Whitney didn't bother to hide her feelings. She wanted everyone to know exactly just how hurt she was over the loss of Dax. She sobbed almost constantly, as if she had been the only one to have lost someone. Maddie was upset, but she hadn't known Dax well enough to be outwardly torn up about it. She was never much for showing her emotions. It probably had something to do with her upbringing. Sometimes it was better if Freddie didn't see how things made her feel. He would resort to mocking. Freddie would try to make anyone who was upset feel small, especially if he thought the sadness was too much. But of course, Maddie was sad. We all were. But she was more worried about who would be next. And honestly, I couldn't blame her for feeling that way, because I did too. "How are we for gas?" I asked. Blake looked at the dash as he drummed his fingertips on the steering wheel.
"We'll be good for a while yet."
We'd stopped and siphoned what we could, but I couldn't stop worrying about the next time we'd have to get gas or use the bathroom. I hated stopping the car, because every time we stopped, I feared it would be the last time. It was just a matter of time before something happened again. Dangers lurked around every corner, and there wasn't anything we could do to ensure our safety. The sick could spread their virus, or those who remained that weren't sick would do whatever they had to, as long as they survived. No one cared about anyone else. Maybe no one ever had. There were no laws to keep people in order, no social rules. Kindness was practically extinct. The only people I had to worry about were those inside the SUV with me. There wasn't much I could do to protect them, but that didn't mean I wouldn't try. Although I had cared a lot about Dax, and look where that had gotten him. I couldn't believe how much I missed him. We hadn't known each other long, but he was like the sunshine on a rainy day. He could make me smile while the walls crumbled down around me. And now it felt like all I'd been left with was the dark, stormy clouds. I couldn't do or say anything, because Blake and Whitney had both known Dax for their whole lives. Who was I to be upset that he was gone? I could keep my pain hidden. I'd done it for years living with Freddie, and honestly, it was the best thing to do. It was a skill I possessed, one I never thought would be of much use beyond the four walls of Freddie's home.
"I need to use the bathroom," Whitney said.
"You have the smallest bladder in the whole wide world,"
Maddie teased. Whitney bit her lip. "There aren't that many people left, so that's not hard to accomplish anymore, is it? Not a whole lot of competition."
"Do I need to find a house, or will a shrub do?"
Blake asked, with nothing but seriousness on his face as he glanced in the rearview mirror at Whitney.
"Shrub," Whitney said. "Tree, tall plant, out in the open, whatever. Just stop."
Blake chuckled. He looked out of the windows and checked the mirrors before cautiously pulling over to the side of the road.
"Who's coming with me?" Whitney asked.
There was a long pause. We all knew there was only one acceptable answer to that question. I reached out and pulled the handle on the door, popping it open a few inches.
I forced myself to swallow down the groan that was rumbling up my throat. "Let's go," I said. Blake grabbed my hand before I could step out of the SUV. He held out his gun to me. "Here, take this."
"She'll be quick," I said, as I tried to stop the trembling in my fingers. I wasn't sure I would ever get used to holding a gun.
Blake shook his head as he pressed the gun against my palm.
"Good, and you'll have this just in case there is a problem."
"I'll scream if there is a problem," Whitney said.
"I have no doubt about that,"
Blake said, his eyes still on me.
"Take it."
I swallowed hard, unable to shift my eyes away from the gun.
"Fine." "Come on, kid," Whitney said, hanging halfway out of the SUV.
I stepped out onto the crunchy gravel at the side of the road. A gentle breeze whispered past my cheeks, and I deeply sucked in the much-needed fresh air. The air inside the SUV had been stale, but it was almost as if my body had become accustomed to it. I shivered at the brisk coolness as the air came in through my nose. It was like I'd stuck my head inside a refrigerator and inhaled. It almost seemed as though I could even smell the rotting leftovers in the back. I followed Whitney through the overgrown weeds.
"How about here?"
"No, they can see me here," Whitney said.
"They aren't going to look," I groaned. "I thought you were willing to go out in the open."
"I was exaggerating. I don't think I can go if I think they are watching," Whitney said. "Shy bladder, I guess."
"What about me?"
I asked, biting away my smirk. Whitney flicked her narrow-eyed glance at me over her shoulder. "What's wrong with you?"
"It was a joke," I said. "I don't want to watch you go to the bathroom either."
"Super funny," Whitney said. I pressed my lips together.
"Whatever. Blake's going to freak out if we go much further."
"Just over there, behind that tree," Whitney said, pointing roughly 30 feet away from where we were. "If I don't piss myself before then, that is."
"Well, you could just go here," I suggested.
"With nothing to hide behind?" Whitney asked. "What kind of animal are you?"
The ground was squishy, and mud was gathering around the edges of my shoes. We were walking through what seemed like a farmer's abandoned field. Something squeaked near me, and the grasses moved wildly as it scattered away. Whitney must have heard it too, because she let out her own little squeak, hopping forward quickly, as though there were hot coals under her feet.
"I can't believe this is my life. What I wouldn't give to have access to a normal bathroom again,"
Whitney said in a razor-sharp tone she tried to half-heartedly disguise with a cough. She still blamed me for everything. "We shouldn't have been on the road. We should still be sitting comfortably inside Blake's house." It was weird that she couldn't understand. Didn't Whitney have someone she would do anything for? Wouldn't she have gone to the ends of the earth for Dax and Blake? I would do anything for Polly. Besides Maddie, she was all I had left. And even though this was entirely Maddie's idea, it had been the right thing to do. Polly was my sister. It wasn't like I even really had a choice in the matter. I just hadn't realized it as quickly as Maddie had.
"Okay," Whitney said, holding up her hand. "You stay here. Any closer might cause issues for me."
"Issues," I muttered quietly as she walked away from me and carefully positioned herself behind the tree. I checked the area next to the tree, although I wasn't sure exactly what I was looking for. The sick? Bad guys? That pesky mouse? I turned my back to the tree. The last thing I wanted to do was cause her any further issues. I crossed my arms and waited. My nerves were starting to twitch.
"Everything okay?" I called over my shoulder.
"Yes," Whitney called back. "Did you bring the toilet paper?"
"Are you kidding?" I asked.
"No. Why would I joke about that?"
I sighed loudly.
"Why would I have been the one to remember it?" "Ugh, hold on. I'll be right back."
I walked 10 feet, sinking down deeper into the mud the quicker I walked. Something caught my eye in the distance.
My eyes shifted to the left at the spot moving on the horizon. It was just a dot, but it was coming toward us fast. I glanced over my shoulder at the tree Whitney was waiting behind. There wasn't time to get her the toilet paper. I wasn't even sure there was time for us to get back to the SUV. Shit, I said under my breath. I turned around, stomping through the mud toward the tree. Something scampered away from me in the weeds, but I didn't let it slow me down. I drew in a breath. Whitney, we have to go. Chapter 2. Whitney was still squatting there, holding onto the tree as she whipped her head around to look at me. Her eyes were dazed, wide saucers, and her mouth was stretched awkwardly with confusion. There's someone coming, I shouted at her as I waved my hands. A car! She pulled up her pants and started running toward me without hesitation. Sheer terror filled her eyes so much that she looked similar to one of the sick. Of course, that wasn't possible. Otherwise, I would have run off without her, leaving her stuck in the mud. Hurry, I said, pulling my foot out of the thick, paste-like mud with each step. It felt like I was stuck inside a dream where I couldn't run. The distance between the SUV and us felt like it was impossibly far. I could see Blake's head darting around anxiously. There was no doubt in my mind he'd seen the car coming our way. Come on, Whitney, I said, stretching my hand back to her. Our fingertips brushed together for a second, but she was out of reach. I glanced back, and she wasn't behind me. My eyes darted around. Whitney, I called. Don't leave me here, Whitney begged as she worked to get to her feet. Her hands were coated with mud. I stepped back and grabbed her arm, helping her to her feet. I'm not going to leave you. Thunder rumbled somewhere in the distance, which increased the rate at which the blood pumped through my veins. The SUV was only 20 feet away, but the car heading toward us was moving faster than Whitney and I could move through the bumpy field. We had no choice but to move faster if we didn't want to find out who was inside the car speeding toward us. Come on, Whit, I urged. We need to go faster. I'm trying, Whitney said, wiping away a tear with her muddy hand. Don't try, just do, I said, grabbing her tighter as I dragged her behind me. The car speeding toward us couldn't have been more than 2 miles from the SUV. Whitney and I were both breathing heavily as we crashed against the side of the car. Whitney's muddy fingers fumbled with the door handle. Panic squeaked out from between her lips. I opened the door for her at the same moment Blake popped open the passenger side door. The sounds from the car zooming towards us mixed with the distant thunder. Let's go, let's go, let's go, Blake hollered. We're going as fast as we can, I mumbled under my breath as I shoved Whitney into the SUV, not caring that she was only halfway on the seat when I closed the door. I jumped into the passenger seat, and Blake stepped on the gas before I slammed my door shut. Who is that? Whitney asked. I have no idea, Blake said, glancing in his mirror more than he looked at the road in front of him. But I have a guess. You do? I asked. Blake offered a quick nod, gripping the steering wheel tighter with both hands. James or his guards. I don't know who else would be trying to get to us so fast. Maybe it's those farmers again, Maddie said. They tried to get us too. I don't think the farmers would be out this far, Blake said. I suppose it could be anyone. Damn it. Whitney hugged herself. Maddie's arm was stretched out over the back of the seat as she stared out the back window. Our supplies were stacked so high, it didn't leave a large gap, but it was enough to see. They're in camo, Maddie said. I think it's that guard, the one that shot. Maddie swallowed hard as she turned and met my eyes. At us. Shit, Blake said, slamming his hands against the wheel. I'm not stopping. Let them run us off the road. They're just following, Maddie reported. I shifted my eyes to the side mirror. She was right. They weren't trying to speed up and tap our bumper. Nor were they starting to pass so they could drive us into the ditch. They were simply following, albeit much too closely. What are we going to do? I asked. Blake shook his head. I don't know. I can try to lose them,
But if this turns into a game of who has more gas, I can tell you, they'll win.
There are three of them in there, Maddie said. Two in the front, one in the back. How many bullets are in your gun?
Maddie, I said, surprise filling my eyes.
I have enough, Blake said, stiffening his jaw. Enough.
I shook my head. This is what we're going to become? Murderers?
We're going to be survivors, Blake said. We didn't start anything with them. They're the ones riding my bumper.
Blake glanced into the mirror.
Maddie, get your head down. You too, Whitney.
Blake stepped on the gas to test them, and as expected, they kept up their pursuit. They weren't in a hurry. They were most definitely following us.
Damn it, Blake muttered. I was going to go around that town up ahead, but now I think we might need to go right through it. Could be our only chance to lose them.
It's like 4 miles away, I said.
Do you have a better idea?
Blake asked with a soft chuckle. The tone indicated, however, that he didn't find anything even a little funny.
Because if you do, I'm all ears.
I chewed on my cheek.
No, but I sure wish I did. They are just so close to my bumper, Blake said,
his eyes flicking back and forth from the road to the rearview mirror. His knuckles were as white as morning frost on a window.
I'm going to tap my brake.
What if they slam into us? I asked, tugging on my seatbelt.
Let's hope that doesn't happen, Blake said.
His knee stiffened, and the SUV jerked. I blinked and could hear the tires of the car behind us squeal.
Jesus,
Blake said with a small nervous laugh. Sweat beaded up at his temple. Blake's plan worked somewhat because they backed off, although it wasn't enough. They were still following us.
What do they want?
I said, sinking down in my seat. It was odd they hadn't tried to get us to pull over, but that didn't stop me from worrying that they were going to pull out their guns and shoot at the SUV.
They probably want to bring us back, Blake said.
How are they going to do that? Whitney asked. Blake exhaled.
They're not, but maybe they think they're going to capture us, drag us back against our will. What they don't know is, that's not going to work.
There's only three of them, Maddie said. Three guns versus one gun. Doesn't look good for us, I said.
But if they wanted to shoot us, wouldn't they have done that by now? Maddie asked. You'd think, Blake said. I don't think they want us dead.
The country road turned into a smoother, paved city road. There were houses on both sides of the road and mailboxes perched upon posts, like birdhouses at the end of each driveway. We'd made it to the town, but without any other traffic, and without knowing our way around, it was going to be hard to lose James's men.
All right, Blake said. Let's do this.
Blake stepped on the gas and turned the corner so sharply, the wheels screamed at the pavement. I grabbed a hold of the armrest, stopping myself from flopping into Blake's right side.
Hold on,
Blake said as he straightened the wheel. Now you tell us, Whitney groaned.
You'll probably want to just keep holding on until further notice,
Blake warned as he gripped the wheel and made another sharp turn. This time, my body pressed so hard against the door, I was afraid it was going to pop open and I would roll to the ground. We were getting tossed around like a chef's salad, but it was working. The car behind us was still behind us, but with each turn we took, we put more distance between us. Blake turned around another block and then another. The car was zigzagging between the cars and turning around the blocks. It felt like we'd been going in a giant circle.
I think we lost them, Maddie said, peeking over the back seat and out the back window. Maybe,
Blake said, zipping around another corner.
Oh shit, I said, pressing my palms against the dash, hoping to stop myself from flying through the windshield. Look out!
There was no way the guy in the road could hear my warning. Chapter 3. Blake slammed his foot down on the brake. The guy didn't release his hold on the water bottles he was carrying as he dove toward the curb, disappearing from view. Whitney let out a sharp gasp as the SUV came to an abrupt stop, propelling us all forward.
Did you hit him?
Maddie asked in a rather calm voice.
I don't think so,
Blake said, shifting the SUV into park. He put his head down and took in a breath, as if he'd been drowning and finally found air. Blake turned to me with wide eyes.
Is he one of the sick?
The sick don't really gather supplies, do they? I asked, as I slowly looked out my side window. I was afraid of seeing something gruesome that I wouldn't be able to unsee. The man was on the ground only inches away from the front bumper. His eyes bulged as he stared at the front of the SUV. There was no doubt the man was frightened, but he definitely wasn't sick. His hair was a bit wild, as if he were about 6 months overdue for a haircut. The man's eyes were a bright bluish-gray, the same color as a cloudy day where the sun was desperately trying to poke through. He met my eyes, and I noticed they sparkled with a friendly glimmer. It was something I hadn't seen in a while. I wasn't afraid of him, not even the slightest, as I rolled down my window.
What are you doing? Whitney whispered sharply.
Are you okay?
I asked the man on the ground. He stared at me for a long moment, as if he was trying to comprehend what I had asked him. A cheerful smile stretched across his face.
I'm fine, he said, as if he were surprised by that fact. Looks like you folks were in a hurry.
Yeah, I said, as my eyes flicked to the side mirror. The man got to his feet and came closer to the window. I quickly pulled on my mask.
Oh, he said, shaking his head. I'm not sick.
Just a precaution, I said.
Where are you guys going in such a hurry?
He asked, as his eyebrows pinched together. Blake tapped the steering wheel anxiously with his fingers.
We need to say goodbye. Aw, man, I haven't talked to anyone in quite some time now,
the man said, giving us a slightly exaggerated frown. He shook his head and a smile appeared. There was no mistaking, however, that he was disappointed. The man pulled the bottles away from his chest and looked down at his shirt. He held one of the bottles away from his body, and water leaked out in a steady stream, raining down onto the ground.
Damn, he said with a sigh.
He put the bottle up to his lips and sucked down the rest of the liquid. After he finished shotgunning the water, he tossed the empty plastic to the side.
That was rude of me. I should have offered you some. We need to be on our way, Blake said. Sorry for almost hitting you. It's all right. You weren't the first person to try to hit me with their car, and something tells me you probably won't be the last, he said,
laughing as he stuck out his hand toward me. When I didn't take it, he pulled it back.
I guess people probably aren't going to do that anymore, are they? Anyway, I'm Jay Cooper. It's good to know there are still normal people out there. For a while now, I was a bit worried it was just me, left with all the sick people.
I bit my lip. I couldn't stop myself from feeling bad for him. It must have been awful to think you were alone, surrounded by the sick. I grabbed one of the extra masks from the console and held it out to him. Here, you should have one of these.
Why?
Jay asked. So you don't get sick, I said with narrowed eyes. Jay raised a brow and shook his head.
This isn't an easy life on my own. I'll take my chances. Whatever will be, will be.
We all turned at the same time the car slowly drove down the road at the far end of the block. It stopped and backed up before turning down our road. My eyes blurred from the panic that surged through my veins. It felt like there was sand stuck in my throat.
We gotta go, Blake said, pounding the steering wheel. Please step away. Those guys after you?
Jay asked, keeping his hand on the side of the SUV.
They are, Blake answered quickly, which is why we need to go.
The car was maneuvering around another vehicle that had been haphazardly parked in the middle of the road. I could see the grin on the driver's face as they drew closer.
I can help you,
Jay said quickly. He could sense that Blake wasn't going to wait a second longer, even if it meant the guy might lose his fingers. It surprised me when Blake hadn't shifted the SUV into reverse and sped away. He shot a quick glance at Jay.
I know this town like the back of my hand. I have a place you can hide, Jay said. They won't find you. Get in, Blake said, pressing the unlock button on his door before handing me his gun. Keep this on him, and if you need to shoot, shoot.
I wanted to argue, but there wasn't time. Hopefully, I'd have the courage to pull the trigger if it was necessary. Rather, I hoped it wouldn't come to that. James's men were nearly halfway down the block. The man in the passenger seat stuck his head out the window and waved his empty hand.
We just want to talk,
he called out, but the gun in his other hand worried me.
If they wanted to talk, he wouldn't be gripping his pistol in the other hand.
Reverse out of here, Jay instructed. I had that much figured out, Blake said. Keep your heads down.
Blake placed his hand on the back of my headrest and stepped on the gas. He sharply turned the wheel at the intersection and shifted into drive in one swift movement. Gravel spit out from beneath the wheels as Blake floored the pedal, causing the tires to spin briefly on the pavement.
You're going to want to go straight four blocks, then make a left at the stoplights that aren't working, Jay said.
Blake followed his instruction, even though the guy could have been leading us to certain death. Our choices were limited. I drew in a breath.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.